When it rains, it pours. We're going to burn through the rest of this tournament real quick, clear out the backlog of Netrunner videos. We just did game 27, now we're at game 28. 29 and 30, and possibly 31 are coming up. This is a battle between the 12th seed, Seth, playing the Tennin Institute, and the 2nd seed, Jesse, playing Gabe at the Philadelphia, Pennsylvania Netrunner Regional Tournament 2014. It took place on July 19th. I know it's October, late October. But listen, life gets in the way. It takes a long time to make these videos, especially when you're doing a podcast all the time. It's called Geek Nights. I've been doing it since 2005. You should check it out. Just Google Geek Nights. I also do a bunch of other stuff, like guest speaking at various conventions. My cohort is speaking at PAX Australia very, very soon. Perhaps, probably before you've seen this video, maybe. And we will next be at PAX South. So I'll see you at PAX South. This game that you're about to watch, right, contrasted to game 27, is about as opposite as it can get. We saw Dan playing really, really quickly with his Replicating Perfection deck, playing his turn as quickly as possible, making decisions as quickly as possible. This is the opposite of that. This is a slow game. Players take their time thinking about what to do. Right? Play very, very slowly. This is the first time we've seen Jesse in a video for this tournament, so exciting to see what the second seed is up to. We saw the first seed, Cal, my buddy from New York, get hosed in round game one by the most lucky draw in the universe. You can check that video out on my channel, along with Netrunner videos from, you know, tons of other tournaments and the rest of this tournament. So what is Jesse's second seed doing with Gabe? Well, let's find out. We've seen Seth's Tennin deck once before in game 21. You know, I can't knock this deck. It made it all the way this far in the tournament. But the one issue I do have with it, if I was playing it, is that the only way he scores agendas is Trick of Light. Or Clone Retirement, he just scores straight out of hand. So because of that, the only way he has to get Trick of Light back into his hand or deck is with Jackson Howard. He needs, so I guess if he uses all three Tricks of Light, then he can use a Clone Retirement and get 7 points. But I mean, what if one of those gets imped? What if it gets milled by noise? What if, you know, you're relying entirely on Jackson Howard? I would put Archive Memories in this deck if I was, but he doesn't have it. The key here in this game is whether Gabe here can get successful runs constantly to deny the magic advancement counters of the Tennin ability. And so far in turn one, he does it with the Dirty Laundry, and he sees a Toll Booth. Toll Booth. See, I was always, you know, when I first saw the Tennin Institute identity, when it first got leaked or spoiled or whatever you want to call it, I was thinking, aha! You are Jinteki. You make all your servers really scary so that no one wants to run with traps and who knows, evil stuff. So they don't run. And then your turn starts and you put an advancement on an unadvanced card in a remote. And then you advance it 3 more times or 2 more, whatever the case may be, right? And, you know, you can score out like a 4 for 2, just like whoop. You know, as long as you install it unadvanced, it could be a snare or a psychic field. That was my thinking of what you wanted to do with this deck. But apparently what you want to do, and what most people do, is it's like, oh, you get the advancement counter if they don't make any successful runs. So just make sure you ice up like crazy to deny any possibility of a successful run. And as long as the runner can't get a successful run, you're going to get advancement tokens, which you can use for, you know, Trick of Light usually, but also making your ice wall stronger, or maybe you're playing Commercialization, or who knows. So that seems to be the going strategy with Tennin Institute, is just, oh, I get stuff if they don't make a successful run, just don't let them make a successful run. If you install a bunch of crazy remotes, they're going to be able to get a successful run if they want. They just have to be brave enough to run one of those things. So we got a pretty standard criminal layout here, early desperado. Nice forge on what was probably a toll booth, right? You saw the toll booth and you ran R&D. Then the corp installed an ice there. Didn't have enough credits or wasn't going to spend 8 on a toll booth that didn't hit. So nice forge on what cleared it away. There's a replacement ice there now. Nice job double icing HQ. It's Gabe, right? That's going to happen. They have to defend against the siphoning Gabe's ability. Otherwise, you might as well just, if you're going to let Gabe access HQ a bunch, you might as well just forfeit the game. But the fairy is out now, so there's no threats. You know, you can get rid of the Koma Inu threat. And Armitage is nice early game there. You know, if he's not going to get successful runs because Tennin Institute is locking him out, at least he can, you know, just get a bunch of money to get things started, install your programs. He's going for R&D. Sure enough, it's Koma Inu. So he's going to use Fairy on that? Yep, Fairy that. And see R&D. Inazuma. Ooh, put that in front of the something nasty. Inazuma, I think, is the one ice. When I saw, you know, when it was first revealed, I was like, that is the card. That is such a ridiculously good card. I want it so badly. And still playing it, it's still amazing. It's 5 strength, which is really good. It only costs 3 to res for 5 strength, which is crazy, right? A 5 strength, you know, Wall of Thorns costs 8 to res. So, I mean, it costs the same, has the same number of subroutines as Eli. Of course, the runner only has to break one of them, but that's okay. You know, if you put a chum in front of an Inazuma, suddenly they have to break both subroutines, and it's strength 7. Chum Inazuma something nasty is, you know, people have not been thinking about that, right? They're like, you know, the other good thing about Chum Inazuma is if they, you know, if they take out the thing behind the Inazuma usually becomes useless. You know, same thing if you take out what's behind a Chum. But if you Chum Inazuma and they take out the bottom ice, which is what they'll probably do, well, Chum Inazuma is still nasty. That means you got to break 2 subroutines and a 7 strength code gate to not get chummed. You know, and chum is 4 strength, 1 subroutine for 1 credit, so. I don't see any chum happening in this game, though. But yeah, I just love Inazuma. You know, you just put it in front of anything, and it makes it crazy nasty. You know, it's a good way to, like, you know, most runners aren't going to be prepared to break a 5 strength code gate. You can totally get some subroutines to fire by dropping one of those. And we got some subliminal messaging. Subliminal messaging, great, great card for Tennin Institute, right? Your whole game here is all about, you know, I'm going to make sure that the runner does not get a successful run. And so subliminal messaging just sort of stacks onto that. It's like, aha, not only do I get an advancement, I also get these subliminal messagings back and get another credit. So you're sort of doubling down on, you know, the thing that that you're, you know, you're going for, which is, you know, no successful runs. So if there are no successful runs, huge bonus. If there are successful runs, nothing, not good. I would consider playing the Wayland Current. I forget the name of it because I'm stupid. Let me look it up quickly. But it gives you a credit every time they do make a successful run, as long as they don't score. It is called Paywall Implementation. So I think Paywall Implementation in Tennin Institute, granted the Paywall Implementation wasn't out at the time of this tournament, is interesting because it's like, okay, don't make a successful run, and I get my Tennin advancement. Okay, do make a successful run. I get credits from paywall implementation. You're winning either way. And I kind of like win either way than win a whole bunch one way and not win a whole bunch the other way. If you give me the choice, I'll take the I win, I get a bonus no matter what path. That is the path I will take. So, Parasite and that Koma Inu is terrific. Yeah, there might be an Inazuma in front of that Koma Inu, in which case it would be even more terrific. Yeah, but judging by the fact that he threw it out, probably tells you that it was indeed an Inazuma. That we saw earlier. And I kind of like what's going on here for Gabe. He's putting all his pressure on R&D. Get the Corp to use all his ice and money on R&D. Because he's got to stop successful runs. Even R&D runs are still successful runs. And if you invest so much in R&D, you know, force him to blow everything there, then once he's sort of like out for the count, when he's weak, right? It's sort of like a boxing match, right? He gets tired, he gets fatigued, his legs, he's underwater. Then you go for HQ, and boom, Gabe. Count siphon, credits, Gabe. And the Corp won't be prepared for that. Yeah. And just by focusing on R&D so much, the Corp can get distracted. Forget about HQ. Special order, La Femme. Femme in the back HQ ice. That's usually the best place to put your Femme token. And running it. Himitsubako, that's going to get femmed right over. But that kind of sucks to femme that, because now that's like the worst possible thing you could femme, because he'll just pick it up. That's a bummer. Maybe Himitsubako, because the back ice in HQ is such a good ice to femme. Maybe Himitsubako is the best back of HQ ice. Yep, picking that up. You got to res it to pick it up, though. It's the only thing. So it still costs you money, but it costs a lot less than FM costs. A lot less. Whew. It is a lot harder to commentate a game that is slow because there is a lot less that's happening per unit time. I'm getting all distracted by things in my apartment. Oh, Le Grim. That Grim costs a lot to break with a femme, so you know what? Let the femme get trashed. You get a bad pub, and you're getting successful runs, and you're seeing cards. So that's just fantastic. Thanks, Grim. If all you have on that server is a Grim, then I don't really care if I have any programs or not. I mean, you already sort of canceled out, you know, the femme without the token is really garbage. Doesn't do anything. All right, it's just a really bad sentry breaker. You got a mimic in your hand there. You know, you're way better than femme. I mean, sure, it doesn't break grim, but that's okay. I'm sure you'll find another answer for that. And in the meantime, you don't even need to break grim until he puts another ice. There's been a complete denial of advancement tokens. There are none out there whatsoever. Do you see one? I don't see one. All right, so what happened here basically is I had to review this part of the game to see what happened. So the Corp played Celebrity Gift. They mandatory drew and played Celebrity Gift, and that was their turn, right? But they should have had a third click. They didn't spend. They thought they spent the Corp, which is Seth. He thought he spent the third click drawing a card. He didn't actually spend the third click drawing a card, but he said his turn was over. So he sort of cheated himself out of a click, two click turn. So Jesse was like, oh, all right, I'll run R&D with his first click. You know, he's getting ready to go right through the grim for nothing. And then Seth was like, oh, wait a second, I didn't spend my third click. I was going to install this ice here in R&D with that third click. And it's like, so... On the one hand, that's sort of right? But on the other hand, he did not actually, you know, he didn't spend his third click. So sort of meh from both sides there. But it was just a quandary that got parasited, so, and he still got into R&D. Didn't really affect the game too much. You know, he got it. All that was affected was, I guess Seth was reminded, hey, R&D is wide open. He got a free reminder by not spending his click and letting the runner pretend spend their first click. So, no one complained to the judge. You know, he let it go, which is fine because, you know, I think he's in control of the game. You know, he did indeed legitimately, you know, have that extra click, so... Two sure gambles, big money. Two bad pub, one from stealing clone retirement and one from the grim. That's making it real easy to run. Just needs breakers now. He's got some in hand, but he wasn't playing them because the grim was out, but maybe now's the time. He got, you know, the money from the two sure gambles can install breakers. The bad pub and the remaining money could easily cut down the ice. Except, you know, depending on the breakers and the ice. Ooh, it's actually starting to get some advancements over there. It's happening. And is that... That's an upgrade in R&D. Look at that. See? The trick has worked. Mostly, right? Force the Corp against Gabe to invest all that stuff into protecting R&D. And now I think the time is coming near where you got to turn to HQ. The runner does not have much money. The Corp does not have much monies. A Knigget? That'll cut Grim right down. That is amazing against Grim. Oh, but nope. Use it on HQ. Yes. Go for HQ. Inside job, yes. So now you're getting into HQ no matter what, pretty much. No one even res. Access, right? This is the other weakness of Trick of Light and Jackson Howard being your only scoring mechanism, is that while you're waiting to get it set up, you're going to have Trick of Light in your hand, of course, but you're going to have agendas waiting in your hand to be scored. Gabe running HQ a lot, which he's going to do no matter what. That is very strong against a deck like this, where agendas build up in HQ. Man, Gabe is just, that barely didn't cost him anything to get to HQ. It's not good. Okay. Trick of Light happens, finally. Looks like a brain trust. I mean, it works. That's why this deck is this late in the tournament. But it has that weakness. But it wouldn't win this many games if it didn't work. All right, Mimic Corroder, we're seeing, all right, breaker time. Moving the knight over to the Grim. Is he going to run R&D? If he reses another Grim, though, that could be bad news. Also, I don't know about you, I've seen influence spent on Jackson Howard. And Power Shutdown, I think we've seen, maybe, but I have not seen influence really on other things. Archer is a possibility with the clone, as a brain trust, though. It's not a clone retirement, but you know, pretty much any destroyer that is a threat here. Even Ichi 1.0 would be a super threat. This is a last click run. The knight completely neutralizes the Grim, though, which is nice. That Grim has been nothing but a benefit for the runner. Just giving him bad pub. No res. And two bad pub breaks the Grim. It's a free run. Caprice game. See, look at that. Against Gabe, why would you put a Caprice in R&D? You put that on HQ. Why would you put that Caprice? I mean, I guess even if you put it on HQ, there could be some sneak door activity, but at least make him do the sneak door. All right. Caprice game in favor of the corp, which means the run was ended and advancement happens because there were no successful runs that turn. There's a power shutdown for two. So that's the end of Corroder, I'm guessing. Oh, the end of Knight. Oh, good move. Drop the Knight, not the Corroder. If there's a Caprice in R&D, there can't be a Caprice anywhere else. He's unique. Maybe you don't need the Knight for HQ. Maybe you got another knight in your hand that we can't see. Fairy, that'll work. Fairy will defend. What are you up to now? All right, so what would I do, right? If we're going to spend such a long time in this game, let's think about what we would do. I mean, you could just run HQ, drop the fairy, run HQ. Oh, there's only one click left? Just put the fairy down, maybe. You're going to do it eventually anyway. Take a credit, I guess? Yeah, take a credit. Oh, he's running archives, and he's getting a desperado credit when he succeeds in that run. Okay. I guess that it's the same as if you're going to take a credit, you also have a chance of denying the advancement counter. I think he paid for that advancement counter there. Just telling you, Trick of Light setup is coming. All right, drop the fairy and running HQ. If he's paying for advancement counters, it means he probably has an agenda and a Trick of Light he wants to use. You haven't accessed R&D. He has drawn cards. Running archives actually was also good because there was that power shutdown. So there were cards. The corp did not want to be in archives that were in there. And there was no Howard on the table. Going for HQ, just getting right in. Getting points. Oh, but those are points that the corp wanted you to have. Shut down that Grim. Yeah, shutting down an illicit ice is super good. If they res it again, you get another bad pub. De-resing illicit ice is so good. I like the Crescentis fairy combo myself. Now running R&D without fear. You got a fairy, so Grim won't hurt you. There's no reason for him to res it. It'll just give you another bad pub if he does. The other two ice are the ones that matter. If that middle one's like an ice wall, you got a corroder and two bad pub, you'll cut that down. And then you play the Caprice game with bad pub. You're playing the game with bad pub. Free game. Free Caprice game. And he wins the game. Use the bad pub to trash Caprice. Access. See ice. There is a lot of ice in this Tennin deck. And I guess that makes sense. If you're looking to end the run, you're going to need a lot of ice. You know, if people parasite the ice away, you need more ice to put down to make sure those runs keep getting ended. If you're using Celebrity Gift to get a bunch of money, you want to show them a bunch of ice. So, you know, I guess the only cards you really need to make the deck work otherwise are, you know, a bit of economy, you know, the Tricks of Light, the Howards, the agendas. You know, it looks like the deck is pretty much all ice agendas, Howard, Trick of Light, Caprice, and that's, I don't, what other, oh, shut, we've seen Power Shutdown. What else have we seen? Not much. And he, you know, I think he could probably use a little bit more economy because he can't afford to res most of this ice that he's got. All right. Going for the account siphon. Resing the Grim, give him the third bad pub. Use the bad pub that you got with the fairy to take out that Grim. Corp hardly has any money left. So I don't think they can res the next ice. Nope. Game time. Oh, that was an account siphon. But the... Oh, I see why he did it. Because now he's only has one credit left. There's nothing to siphon. So the runner is unable to get crazy rich off of it. But you gave him a bad pub. So giving a bad pub is, you know, is that really so different from giving him a million credits? So he accesses, sees a Trick of Light. Ooh, this game is long. The buzzer is going to go off at some point. free R&D runs since the corp only has one credit. You could have spent the one credit to res the possible ice wall, but with all those bad pub, it's going to be a free break. One thing, though, is even though it's a free break, if you make them use the bad pub breaking the ice, at least they can't use the bad pub to trash any cards that they might see, which I guess would be Howard in this deck. I don't know if there's no any PDs, I don't think. Digging money. To replace the money you just lost. I guess even though he gave him all the bad pub with the Grim, it's now he can't really account siphon again because the fairy was a one-shot. But an inside job would do it. Data Sucker finally makes an appearance. I think the Corp has four credits, so the Grim Fear, you can't res the Grim on R&D. So R&D, and you... R&D might be a safe run here. He's going for Archives, which gets him a... if he can get Data Sucker or two, then he can run HQ. Hedge Fund. All right, credit Hedge Fund. So the Corp did have Hedge Funds. You need five creds to use them. Finally got up to five credits and was able to double Hedge Fund. He's back in the money. All the ice are on. Who knows what it could be. But thank the two Data Suckers plus Mimic, the Grims are not a threat anymore. As long as you keep the virus counters up. He's going to Archives, though. Try to get more Data Sucker counters. And there's a toll booth on Archives. That's actually not crazy because Sneak Door is a serious threat to the integrity of this deck. Sneak Door is just really good in general lately. Even today with the cards we have now, Sneak Door, I think, is just, you know, it was super strong early in the game's life. Then it got weak as everyone had to defend Archives. I mean, people still have to defend Archives today against Data Suckers or all kinds of stuff. But, you know, Sneak Door right now is just ludicrously good. Because you can just pound HQ with all sorts of stuff, like legwork. You know, even if you're not a criminal, you can be pounding HQ. Agendas will build up in there. You know, and then... Trick a light out that Philotic Entanglement. That's going to do two damage. He's just using it because it's a 3-for-2. But, hey, there's a legwork, speak of the devil. And a Sneak Door, speak of the devil. Well then, yeah, if that ice on Archives was weaker than a toll booth, that Sneak Door could have wreaked havoc. Right, if he happens to draw an agenda before, you know, uh-oh, 5 points, those free R&D runs. There's a Howard, use bad pub to trash that. See, if you were to res the, you know, another Howard, another more bad pub trash is that. I'm not paying close enough attention to the twirling dice to see if he spent the bad pub or credits to trash those Howards. See, this is why he's dependent entirely on Jackson Howard and Trick of Light in order to score. Tricks of Lights and Jackson Howards now are in the archives. It's going to be a long time before he can score anything again. How is he possibly going to hold out that long? Installing something unprotected in a remote? What is this deck doing? What is going up? Oh, no, not doing it? Doing it? What is happening here? This is unprecedented. I've never seen this. Maybe it's the third Howard. If it's the third Howard, I think you have to use it to get Howard Trick of Light back into your deck. You know, before your next mandatory draw. If they don't run that Howard, then right before you mandatory draw, I would use it.
So this one's a bad choice.
So the buzzer did go off, but it went off after the end of the corp's turn. So, like, just after he finished his turn. So the runner gets one more turn, the corp gets one more turn. But the corp is basically conceding here. He's got 4 points. The runner has 5 points. There's no... The only way the corp can score is if he somehow gets a clone retirement and Trick of Lights it. Right? Because he doesn't have enough credits to score the clone. He only has 1 credit. So we'd have to get a clone retirement and use Trick of Light to score it to go up to 5, which would be a tie. The runner scores any points on their turn, they win. So that's that. Sort of anticlimactic at the end of such a long game for time to run out. And even in the case of a tie, the runner was the higher seeded player. So they would have just won that game, even if the miracle clone retirement Trick of Light to tie the agenda points had happened. The runner still would have been victorious there. So they didn't even bother playing out. You know, it's like the buzzer went off and it's like, well, that's it then. Yeah, so I guess another problem of, you know, I don't know if it was really necessarily the Tennin deck's fault. You know, everything in this game was slow. Players were really thinking about everything. But, you know, if you're going to play a slow deck, you got to play fast to make it underneath that time limit. Especially, you know, this 10 deck is really slow. You're waiting to draw through the whole deck to find Trick of Lights, you know, to set up score enough times. All right, let us move on to our final two games.